Good afternoon. I'm going to finally talk about the consequences of innovation, particularly the losses thereof. The estimates presented here reveal large losses in indigenous innovation among most of the nations of Western Europe in which dynamism arose in the 19th century. I refer mainly to France, which had lost almost all of its innovation by 1980, and to Italy, which by 1990 lost all of the innovation that had risen in the 60s and 70s during the economic miracle. Germany, after it regained in the post-war years its rank in innovation below France but above the UK and Italy, innovation slid back considerably in the 1970s. In contrast, the UK had lost considerable innovation from the late 50s to the end of the 70s, but regained much of that in the late 80s and the 1990s. My thesis is that the large losses and the narrowing of the scope for innovating, which lies, I think, behind them in many cases, have serious ill effects on society and acute ill effects on a wide range of individuals. What were these ill effects? Well, to begin, recall that innovations in an economy are contributors to gains in its productivity, to total factor productivity, which is a weighted average of labor productivity and capital productivity. The magnitude of the innovation going on is measured by the size of the productivity gain attributed to it. So by definition, a loss in the year's indigenous innovation, as we measure it, is the loss it caused in the year's productivity growth. The incidence of such a productivity slowdown is determined, if it sustains, we'll probably call it a slowdown, the incidence is determined by its effects in markets. It slows the growth of wage rates. At least historically, that's what it's done. It's slowed the growth of wage rates, and as they fall relative to household wealth, the supply of labor is contracted. And it slows business investment, which contracts the demand for labor. It also depresses interest rates, which hurts younger workers who are trying to accumulate wealth for their retirement. So employment levels become naturally depressed, without any deficiency of aggregate demand. It's a structural thing. In standard models, both of these developments both of these developments reduce what in textbooks is called economic welfare. I would note in passing that this set of effects from a productivity slowdown does not differ much from the secular stagnation that Alvin Hansen was talking about as early as 1934, several years before Keynes's general theory. It's a different theory. Hansen wrote that when the volume of savings, household wealth, outruns technological development, investment in new capital falls, creating business stagnation. Stagnation, in other words, results when productivity slows down or accumulated wealth speeds up. And now, by the way, we have a working age population beginning to slow down, or actually beginning to fall. So we have secular stagnation on two fronts, both the technology and the population. True, international trade and investment flows serve to moderate such developments. Decades ago, Paul Samuelson of MIT found some theoretical conditions for what he called factor price equalization. So no matter how a country messes up, people are still going to get the international wage. Later, Zvi Grillitis of Harvard suggested that Europe escapes the costs of reducing its indigenous innovation through technological transfer. The Europeans are so smart, he said. They let the Americans take the risks of innovation, then they copy each year the new products that were successful. Of course, the Europeans might manage in this way to have the productivity growth rate of the United States, if that's the technological leader, but its productivity level would have fallen behind the US level. In any case, the Americans later suffered their own productivity slowdown around 1970. As a result, the European countries losing much of their indigenous innovation, also lost much of the overseas innovation they would otherwise have imported from overseas. So it's no wonder that Europe has been hit really heavily by the productivity slowdown. It's also true that several European nations still suffer to a varying degree from the financial crisis on top of the damage from the secular stagnation. I get so tired of reading the FT every day on the horrible costs of financial crisis, sorry Wolfgang, when there's hardly a word about secular stagnation. It seems to have been completely forgotten. We ought to put the damage from the financial crisis in proper perspective. Yes, business investment as a ratio to the GDP in the EU fell from 7.5% in 2000 to 5.7% in 2014, a fact that Joseph Stiglitz dug out a week or two ago. I don't know how he got that number. But business investment, even after its decline from the mid-70s, as the productivity slowdowns were taking hold, fell further over the next 15 years by a whole lot. In Italy, from 15.7%, that's investment to output ratio, in 1980 to 11.3% in 1995. And in France, from 13% to 10.9% in 1995. Yes, the employment to population ratio among men in Italy dropped from 77% in the early 2000s to around 73% in 2014. But it declined deeply from 87% in the late 70s, when innovation began dying, to 77% in 2000. The labor force participation rate in France dropped significantly from 87.6% in 2000 to 83.8% in 2014, but the decline was greater, from 93.3% in the benchmark year 1973 to 86.6% in the late 1990s. So much greater damage was done by the productivity slowdown than has been done at this point from the financial, by the financial crisis on these simple measures. Interestingly, in Germany, the employment population ratio started the 70s at 92%, then lost some ground in the 90s with German unification, but climbed back to 89% in 2014, not far below the level in the 70s. So what about that? Is that a counterexample to what I was saying? Do the brighter statistics in Italy, and for that matter the UK, put the seculars, the great damage is my mind, put in question my hypothesis that secular stagnation has been very costly? No. The UK's estimated annual innovation is higher in the recent span, 1972 to 2013, than in the previous span, 1946-1972. So from this perspective, it comes no surprise that, did I say Germany before? I'm talking about the UK. The UK's estimated innovation is higher in the recent span, 72-2013, than in the previous span, 1946-1972. So from this perspective, it's not surprising that Britain is doing better. And Germany is the continental country, which is, didn't do so badly recently. Germany is the continental economic country with the smallest loss of innovation from the earlier span to the later span. So all these observations fit very well my theory. From these data and other data, I also infer that the losses of innovation in Europe have brought appreciable declines relative to trend, both in wage rates available to ordinary workers, relative to trend, and in interest rates available to savers from the 70s well into the double aughts. These developments have led to heavy reductions in most people's incomes and wealth relative to past trends and in labor force participation rates. The developments mean diminishing opportunity. People are forced to take less preferred paths of consumption or leisure or both. Now, all that is about the private sector. What about the public sector? Well, the great slowdowns that I've been talking about brought slowdowns of government revenue, which in turn led to budgetary deficits that are endemic these days and seemingly endless. The beneficiaries of social insurance and social assistance are threatened. Moreover, the slowdown malady that has hit the once dynamic nations of continental Western Europe is bringing political uncertainty about what can be done and what will be done. And that, in turn, is apt to bring political instability. Note that these costs of the losses in innovation, the diminishing opportunity, and the public sector crisis are societal. I wish Saskia Sassen had gotten here in time to hear this talk, because I'd like to have at least one sociologist to pronounce on my use of the term societal. I think it's correct. The social benefit cutbacks are everyone's cutbacks. The slowdown of the general level of wages, relative to trend, is everyone's slowdown. But a great many people earn rewards from economic life that are not societal. These rewards are very much individual, specific to the person gaining them. As some observers have said, Kenneth Bowling and Louis Meher. There's also Tony Blair, and somebody contributed Mitt Romney. As these observers have said, a person may value attainments, attaining things through one's own effort and talent. In my book, I had forgotten, but it turns out that in my book, Mass Flourishing, 2013, I've used the word prospering. I use it to refer to the experience of succeeding in one's work. A craftsman's gratification at seeing his hard-earned mastery result in better work, or better terms for the work he does. A merchant's satisfaction at seeing his ships come in. Or a scholar's sense of validation from being awarded an honorary degree. Various scholars, Thorsten Veblen, John Dewey, Abraham Maslow, speak of a person's satisfactions from using his or her ingenuity and knowledge, workmanship, to solve problems. A person who, over a career, has the pleasure of developing such capacities is said to be experiencing personal growth or self-realization. Lastly, several of the greatest writers and philosophers, Montaigne and Voltaire, Cervantes and Shakespeare, Kierkegaard and Nietzsche, portray a full life, a life of richness, as a personal journey into the unknown, marked by an interior struggle, the fascination of uncertainty, the excitement of acting on the world. That sort of life is often what is meant by the term flourishing. To have such engaging lives, working age people need more than a secure job at the going wage, a work in which they have very little, a little or no autonomy. They need to have human agency to be able to take the initiative, to express their thoughts, and explore new paths. Okay, what sort of economy might, to a large degree at any rate, offer all this prospering, this personal growing and flourishing? Clearly it must be an economy in which actors are exploring, theorizing, imagining. Actors are exploring, theorizing, imagining, creating, testing, and discovering. I've discovered that several Western nations, mostly Western European nations, developed in the 19th century, I've argued, that these nations developed in the 19th century just such an economy full of entrepreneurial people, people alert to unnoticed opportunities, searching for better ways of doing things, exercising their initiative to try out new things, and an economy full of innovative people, people imagining new things, developing new concepts into commercial products and methods, and marketing them to potential. The innovation in the enterprise sector was pervasive, stretching across industries, and inclusive, rising from society's grassroots to the people who are advantaged. You can feel the enthusiasm for this period in those countries, in Lincoln's Young America, in Harold Evans' Saga of the Innovators in America, in Emma Griffin's trove of diaries plucked from the British Library, and Gershwin's America in Paris. This was a life of richness. In the once dynamic economies, dichotomies that have lost so much of their dynamism, most acutely Italy and France, this life of richness seems to me to have largely slipped away. It's available to fewer and fewer. This loss is very serious, far worse than the slowdown of wage rates and the fall of interest rates. The fact that Italy and France are at the bottom in job satisfaction in the usual tables is for me evidence that the Italians and the French badly need more engaging careers. What is at stake in then is not so much productivity growth as modern life itself.
I think